Well, we're here to talk about life today, human life. Small subject, right? I think we can probably accomplish that in 20 minutes or so. It's an interesting thing to preach on Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. It's interesting because of the reactions that people have, even to the thought of coming to church on this particular Sunday. You may not feel this way, but some dread it, and they want to stay away. Because they just don't want to hear the same old message about abortion again. They've heard the statistics, and we'll put some of them up on the screen for you. 4,000 abortions a day, an average of 1.46 million each year, and a staggering 55 million since 1973 and the Roe v. Wade decision. And people, some, just don't care to be beat over the head with all of that again, even if it's all true, and it is. Others, to the contrary, are eager to come to church because for them it's a message, an issue that we talk about far too little in the church. And they believe that Christians, pastors perhaps in particular, need to send a strong message to the culture, to the world on this issue. You may be glad to know that I don't intend to preach the same old message today. I believe that almost all of us, if not all of us, know clearly that abortion is wrong. It is a horrific, heinous sin in the sight of our holy God. Most of the women who have abortions in this country probably believe that too, believe it or not. Most women don't choose to abort their child because they think it's right. They do so because they think it's necessary. It seems like the only way out for them, the only solution to the fear, the dread, the anxiety that they're experiencing deep in their souls. And 99 out of 100 probably feel more guilt, more shame, more self-loathing and deprecation than they do relief when it's all said and done. So I agree, I don't think we necessarily need to hear the same message again. But I also agree that the church needs to send a strong message to the culture, to the world on this issue. And the question is, what exactly is the strong message that the world needs to hear? I've thought about that a lot this week, and the Lord led me to the 11th chapter of John's Gospel, which I think gives us a great deal of help in answering that. The chapter really hits the nail on the head here because it deals with the ultimate subject of life and death, and that's what everything boils down to here. The question is, are you dead or alive? Yeah, you can go to John 11, that's okay, we'll get there. Are you dead or are you living? And I ask that question in two different ways because you can be living physically, I mean breathing, eating, moving about, and be dead spiritually. And the opposite is true as well. You can be dead physically and yet alive spiritually. In God's view, life is more than blood pumping through the arteries and oxygen being transported through the lungs and neurons firing in the brain and all of that. Life is eminently spiritual. It's because we were created in the image of God, and God is spirit. So we don't look like God in a physical appearance sense. We look like God in a spiritual sense, and it is the spirit in man that God is most concerned about. Well, let's go to our text and look at the story in John chapter 11. It is the story of the raising of Lazarus. And we'll start right at verse 1, John 11. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. Yet when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. Then he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago the Jews tried to stone you, and yet you are going back there?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees by this world's light. It is when he walks by night that he stumbles, for he has no light." After he had said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought that he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I'm glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Then Thomas, called Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." And we'll end our reading there, although the story does continue. Well, this was kind of a strange conversation between Jesus and the disciples, wasn't it? It may seem rather strange to us if we don't understand the difference between physical and spiritual death. Did you know that there are two different kinds of death? Physical death, obviously, the cessation of life in your mortal body. We all get that. That's the first death. But there's also spiritual death, which is the end of any possibility of a relationship with God. The Bible calls that the second death. And I want to have us just look at some scriptures all in the book of Revelation that refer to the second death. So let's open our Bibles to the last book, to Revelation. We'll look at a verse in chapter 2, and then we'll go to the very end of the book. Revelation 2:11. "He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt at all by the second death." And that's Jesus speaking there. Those are red letter words. And then flip over to chapter 20, if you will. Verse 6, first of all. "Blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. These are great promises. Jump down to verse 11, please. "Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. Earth and sky fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them, and each person was judged according to what he had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire." This is pretty sobering, isn't it? Okay, chapter 21, verses 6 to 8. "He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of the water of life. He who overcomes will inherit all this, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death." Whew, glad we got through that. So spiritual death is the state of being permanently condemned by God to a place of separation from him. Obviously, that's what we know as hell. By understanding these two different forms of death, we can make a little better sense of what Jesus says in this story of Lazarus. And we can especially make sense of what Jesus says to Martha in verse 25, which we didn't get to, but it's a familiar verse. He says, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. Whoever lives and believes in me will never die." Hallelujah. Okay, so what? So what? The so what is this. Physical death is not the death that ultimately matters, and it's not the death that people ought to fear. According to Jesus, for someone who knows him personally, as Lazarus did, physical death is just like going to sleep. It's kind of hard to go to sleep last night. The wind was howling around our house. Well, no, under normal circumstances, it's like going to sleep. It's like sleep because it's not the end. You're going to wake up to another life. And there's great comfort in that, isn't there, Leota? And all of you who have lost loved ones in recent days, they just wake up in paradise. King David says at the end of Psalm 17, "And I in righteousness," which we are in righteousness in Christ, "will see your face when I awake." He's obviously referring to death, but he says, "When I awake, I will be satisfied with seeing your likeness." That's in the Psalms. The death that really matters most, the death that people ought to fear, is spiritual death. Eternal separation from God. Let me put it to you this way. If you're dead physically, nothing else in this life matters. Right? It's gone. It's behind you. It's done. But if you're dead spiritually, nothing in the next life matters. To that, I would have to add that if you have been made alive in Christ and you have received the spiritual life that he offers, everything to do in this life and everything in the next life matters supremely. It's all for Christ. It's all for the glory of God. That is why the Apostle Paul says in 1 Timothy 6:19, "Take hold of the life that is truly life." When you put your trust in Christ, it takes on a whole new meaning, a whole new destiny for sure, but a whole new sense of purpose. You become alive as a human being. German theologian Reinhold Niebuhr, who was one of my favorites when I was in college, once said that the glory of God is man fully alive. I like that. Jesus spoke about the glory of God in our text today. Did you notice? Let's look at verse 4 again. Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Well, Lazarus did die, but Jesus isn't lying here. Of course, he never lied. Because in the end, Lazarus wasn't dead. His sickness did not end in death. He was alive. But how was God glorified through this? If you look at verse 14 again, it says, "Then he told them plainly, 'Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad that I was not there, so that,'" what does it say? "So that you may believe." So that's the whole reason Jesus stayed where he was for two more days. It was to help the disciples, to help everyone else who was standing there around Mary and Martha from the community, to help all of them to believe in him. Now, if you jump down to verses 40 to 42 of the chapter, it says, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." Oh, Jesus really wanted people to believe in him. Jesus still wants people to believe in him. He wants you to believe in him if you don't already. And he tells us why earlier in this gospel. In chapter 5, Jesus says, I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death into life. Jesus wants people to believe in him because it's the only way that they will be spared, that they will escape the condemnation of the second death and have eternal life. But listen, it's not only a matter of getting eternal life. From what Jesus says in this verse, it's clear that anyone who's living on this earth without knowing him isn't really living yet. They're not fully alive. Because he says they've crossed over from death to life. And notice, he doesn't say that they've crossed over from earthly life to eternal life. He means that they've crossed over from spiritual death to spiritual life. He goes on in the next verse in John 5 to explain that. He says, I tell you the truth, a time is coming and has now come when the dead, he means spiritually dead people, will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear, implied respond, will live, spiritually live. Can you hear the voice of the Son of God today? Can you hear Jesus saying, I love you? I can forgive you. I will forgive you. I do forgive you. I died for you. Do you know what would bring God great glory today? Is for you to not only hear those words, but to wholeheartedly believe it, if you don't already. Let's talk about abortion, though. Many times, those who have been through the painful experience of abortion have a hard time hearing that voice, hearing God's voice. And they have a hard time believing that God is speaking to them or believing what God is saying, even in his word. And I know that from speaking to a number of people who've had this experience, who've been through an abortion. They feel outside of God's grace, maybe even God's reach. God's grace is all about life being restored, life being reclaimed, becoming alive, fully alive again in Christ. And I want to read you something this morning. This is actually a letter. A true letter written by a mother who aborted her child. The letter was dated January 2, 2005, so a little more than 8 years ago. And I'll keep the names out of it, doesn't matter. Quote, to my baby, I am sorry that I took your life away. You never got to take your first breath of life. I never got to hear your cry or hear you call me mommy. You will always be forever in my heart, but never in my arms. I cut your innocent life short because I was so scared. I can't stand to be away from you now. No matter how far we are apart, you will always be here deep in my heart. I long to hold you, to hear your cry, to see you grow. But it's something I will never be able to do. I hear you cry in the silence of the night. I wake and I run to your side. I go to your crib to get you, and you're not there. If I could, I would give you life, but I can't. You are lost to me, and my life will never be the same without you. I am so sorry, baby. You never had a face or a name that I could recognize, but you'll always be mine, and your memory will always be near. I know that you are home safely in Jesus' arms. Your mommy and grandpa and grandma, we all love you so much. The sun will shine on my heart when we meet again. So I let go of your hand, baby, but I say hold fast to Jesus' hand. Because he loves the little children. I love you, your mommy. Friends, if we are to be a true fellowship of Jesus Christ, we must learn how to help people like this, like the person in that letter, understand God's grace. And we must learn how to deal with hurting people like this in a spirit of grace, not judgment, grace. I had to ask myself this week, so how well, Paul, do you think you really understand grace? I like to think I understand it pretty well. James Ryle, a theologian and author, has a kind of a radical, non-traditional understanding of grace. In fact, he once wrote a book entitled Revolutionary Grace. It's a good read. Most people in the church define grace, he says, as the unmerited favor of God. It has been touted for centuries as God giving us what we don't deserve. That's not grace, says Dr. Ryle. That's mercy. But even if it is grace, here's the problem. If you're a person who has committed some really bad sin, or a person who has committed some sin with great regularity and frequency, even enjoying it, you might believe in your head that you don't deserve God's favor, but still feel in your heart that you do deserve God's punishment. And you think that ultimately that's what you're going to get. After all, you wonder, how could God really, truly, totally forgive someone who has done something so terrible or who's done so many wicked things? People who've had abortions sometimes feel this way, and they may exclude themselves from the fellowship of the church because they feel so unworthy. They figure the church is for people that God loves, and he can't possibly love me. Not after what I've done. Now, I said people who've had abortions, not women, because it's not just women who experience this. Priscilla would be quick to tell us that men go through much of the same emotional, psychological anger and angst as women do. And what these women and men need to experience in the church and need to come to know in their hearts is this powerful grace of God to restore their lives. I like how Dr. Ryle defines grace. Take a look at this. Grace is the empowering presence of God that enables you to be all that God created you to be and to do all that God has called you to do. Now, men and women who have made the decision to abort a child often don't feel the presence of God. If anything, they often feel the absence of God. And those who have aborted usually don't feel like their life will ever amount to what it could have been or maybe should have been. Too much has been lost. Part of them has died and is just gone forever, as we heard in that letter. And those who have aborted usually don't feel like they will ever do what God might have called them to do because they think, why would he call me to do anything for him now? Why should he give me any attention, any blessing, or want to use me for anything? Brothers and sisters, let's answer this next question as honestly as we can. Are these thoughts and these feelings that I'm describing unique to people who have gone through an abortion? Or do they often apply to others of us who gossip or lust or have critical spirits or tell lies or commit any other form of sin? Seems to me that most everyone struggles with these things. So what are we, church, supposed to tell them? And what do we ourselves need to hear? I began this morning asking the question, what is the message that the world needs to hear? Here's the answer that I'd like to give you today. Jesus Christ will not only forgive the sin of abortion and every other sin, but he will give new life to those who believe in him, just as John says in his gospel. Well, I need to close because I want you to hear all of what Priscilla needs to say this morning. But let me say this before I close. If you or someone that you know, granddaughter, friend of a granddaughter, grandniece, whoever, if someone that you know is needing help in making a decision about an unplanned pregnancy or needs help in dealing with the psychological trauma and the aftermath of an abortion, I encourage you with them to seek good help. And by good help, I mean people who are genuinely caring, genuinely compassionate, genuinely not condemning of that person for their condition, their state, whatever you want to call it, the mistakes they've made. I would encourage you to send them to Priscilla at Muskegon Pregnancy Services. She's got lots of great trained counselors on staff. We have Laura Ecker here on our own staff, professional counselor. Ann Davidson is another one in our congregation who's been trained. Or you can come to me. But sometimes people want to talk to somebody outside of the church, in which case I would definitely say they should go to Muskegon Pregnancy Services, because confidentiality is always protected in that environment. The concern is not so much who you see, but it's that you see someone. These kinds of things are not dealt with very well on one's own. And yet many do try to struggle through it very, very alone. And it's a hard road. But before they or you even pursue such a conversation with one of us or with whoever, there's another important person they need to talk to. And that person is none other than the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of life, who, may I remind all of us, and may we always remind others, that he loves you with a perfect love. He loves you. And he can put the pieces of a post-abortive life back together in such a way that they are fully alive again. Thanks be to God. That's the hope for every one of us, no matter what we've done. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for your word to us this morning. It's a difficult word, Lord. But I trust it has been a needful word. Lord, we thank you that because we were made in your image, we can find our identity in you. Father, help us to understand our human worth through your eyes and by your standards and not that of the world. Enable us to see ourselves and others the way you see us, understanding that you have crowned us with glory and honor and given us dominion over the works of your hands, and that you love us with an everlasting love. Lord Jesus, reveal to us this morning that we can only find our own completeness in you, as the head of all principalities and powers, as the Lord of all creation. Jesus, give us the peace and the security of knowing that we are accepted by you, not rejected by you, no matter how great our sin. Oh Lord, free us from the self-consciousness and the self-focus that imprisons our souls in guilt and shame and fear. Help us to see who we really are today as forgiven and free. And may our true self-image be the image of none other than Jesus Christ, stamped deep upon our hearts. And we ask all this in his matchless and precious name. Amen.